It's Monday, the traditional day of opening things. Today's beer is Sidewinder Vienna Lager from TransCanada Brewing in Winnipeg. Ooh, and cool artwork. Gotta love a train picture. That is not bad. It's not nearly as dark as what I usually drink, but I don't mind that at all. First in, we have Plastic Sheet. Wow. I actually got some plastic sheets a few weeks ago. Let's see if this is more of that. No, it's not. This is a roll of tape. It's kind of stuck to the bag. Oh, this is that. It's not 3M tape, it's M3 tape. It is a, what is that, ultra high molecular weight, I think is what they call that. Basically, it is a slightly thick. It is a kind of a thick tape. It's sticky on both sides. It's a little bit compliant. This is mounting tape. A lot of these LED strips will have some of this on the back of it, but it's also good for mounting basically things to other things. The tape itself is kind of stretchy, but it is quite sticky even when it is stretched out. 3M Strong Permanent Double-Sided Super Self-Adhesive Sticky Tape Roll Adhesive. As we saw, it's not actually 3M, it's M3, which is, you know, completely whatever. I got this from Horizon Electronic for $1.86 with free shipping. I bought the 10mm. It seemed like a reasonable size. But they also have it in everything from 6mm up to 20. It claims it's permanent. I'll have to try it on some different surfaces in the future and just see what happens. Next in, we have modules. Says plural, do you think? Yes, it is more than one. What is this USB guy here? Let's start with that. Looks like some sort of a USB to serial. I'm wondering if that matches the pinouts of either the basic ESP266 or maybe the NRF board. Does that give me any clues? Yes, it does. USB to ESP266. Okay, so that's for the basic ESP266. It's just got Wi-Fi on one side and a serial port on the other side. Basically, you can see there that's a receive data, transmit data. So there's a couple of extra pins on there, but not much. That was one of the earliest ESP266 styles that you started to see getting popular. That's the one that people tended to use to make these guys Wi-Fi capable. Just hang that, or hang not this board, but the board that plugs into there, off the serial port of this guy, and boom, you've got a Wi-Fi Uno. So what is the chip on here? Okay, CH340. Nice, simple USB to serial port chip. So I could actually use this for any USB to serial application if I chose to. It just happens to have the pinout for that ESP266. Development board adapter, USB to ESP8266 serial wireless Wi-Fi module from GC Supermarket. Currently they're selling for $1.60 American or $2.12 Canadian. I got this one at auction for $1.39. What do they have to say about it? Not much to say about it. So the module that's intended to plug into these is this one here. I just pulled it from a random seller. Somebody I've bought from before. So they are just the ESP01, which only has a couple of GPIO on it, but it can just be used as a nice, cheap, simple Wi-Fi to serial interface. He's selling them for, what, a couple of bucks each? That's not bad if that's all you want to do.
Let's see what this other guy is.
Oh, that is an ESP266. But this is, I think, the ESP12 variant. Let me just pop it out of its little surface mount ensconcement here.
So normally you don't get these packaged like this. At least I haven't seen them like this. This is a pick and place tape. There'd be like hundreds of them strung out that way. So yeah, this is just the bare ESP8266. It's got these castellated pins along the edges here. This is in fact the ESP8266-12 version. There's a bunch of different versions of them. This is one of the more common ones. It is the one that shows up on the Wemos D1 and the D1 Mini. And it has sort of the most versatile complement of pins among the ESP8266 family. At least that's the one that hobbyists tend to use the most. And you can see them all broken out there. It doesn't have as many pins as a proper Uno, of course. But that's not its major trick. Its major trick is that it's Wi-Fi and it's got some I.O. pins. It's got a handful of digital I.O. pins. It's got Mozzie Miso if you want. It's got UART serial on it. It's got one analog input, a few PWM outputs. So you can use it for, you know, a good number of your Wi-Fi little projects, and they're cheap. And there is one of these guys, a bare one, in there running the YouTube subcounter approximator thing. ESP8266, ESP-12E, serial port, wireless Wi-Fi transceiver board module, AP plus STA, access point or station mode. So it can be its own Wi-Fi source, or it can be a Wi-Fi client. Also from GC Supermarket, currently selling for $1.88 American or $2.49 Canadian. I got it for $1.85 Canadian, which I think's not a bad deal. Yes, it doesn't have all the extra stuff that that a D1 Mini has, and a D1 Mini's not that much more, really, especially not that much more than this. Currently, they look like they're going between, oh, there's a fairly cheap one, $290. Up to 372. And of course it can do all the things that the D1 Mini can do too. You just have to mount it up yourself. It makes it a little bit smaller if you need it to go inside a small project. That's kind of handy. Or of course you could just use it for a serial port adapter, the same as that ESP01 that I bounced past quickly there earlier. So yeah, all standard ESP8266 stuff here. Nothing surprising at all. Next in, we have modules again. Cool. I like modules. Modules are fun. I'm seeing a wiring harness. I'm seeing a bunch of DuPont wires, male to male. Okay. Nothing super exciting here. These are just always handy to have kicking around, and I find that I tend to use the short ones the most, and I also tend to find that I prefer this kind, the ones with kind of the shrinky sort of a tip on them, or these are more of a molded tip rather than this kind with the crimped on pins, because those pins don't stick very well into breadboards. I mean, they do, once they're in there they hold well, but they don't go in very well. These ones are nice and round and smooth, and they go into a breadboard super easy. 65 pieces, male-to-male, solderless, flexible, breadboard jumper cables, wires for Arduino, from Top Electronic 1980, who appears to be the same company as GC Supermarket. Or they're just swiping their photo and sticking their own on. Currently selling for $1.85 Canadian. I paid $1.35 at auction. So that's... It's, you can always get a few, shave a few pennies off if you can find them at auction, and just be a little bit patient. Next in, this is a demo board QXSHPC5691, whatever that means. Oh, okay. I remember what these are. I've seen them before. This is just a little adapter for the ESP8266 with its castellated pins to adapt it to dip pins so that you can plug it into a breadboard or something like that. There's a set of header pins there.
or you could just solder straight onto those wires if you want to or whatever. There's provision for a 3-terminal regulator on the back. The ESP266 itself runs at 3.3 volts. So if you put a, what is that, a 1117 regulator on the back there, you could put a raw 5 volts into here and give yourself a nice safe voltage for the ESP. Okay. Those are usually pretty cheap. And again, if you recall, when I was building this guy here, I actually mounted it on that just to make it a little bit easier for me to wire to it.
ESP8266, ESP-12E, ESP-12F, wireless transceiver adapter module. I got this one at auction for 29 cents from this seller, Carell49, who doesn't appear to have it in their store anymore. But here is a random store that has them. You can buy them in bulks like that. And pretty much everybody these days seems to be selling them for about 99 cents individually. Pay attention, even though the picture shows bulks of them, it doesn't say there's more than one. It used to convert the ESP7 or ESP12s to 2.544 millimeter pin headers. If you want to put the regulator on the back, this is important if you're going to use it. If you want to put the regulator on the back, remove the middle SMD resistor to make it happen and then solder that on the back. The middle SMD resistor, as you can see, is actually just a 0-ohm link. So if you are going to use one of these boards with the regulator on the back, keep that in mind.
And the fifth thing is modules. Seems to be kind of a modules sort of a special today. Even though not all of them are. Nothing left in there. What is this? Some kind of a power supply module, maybe? Get out! Seeing inductors. Oh! We have 4 USB ports on that side, and we have what looks like a DC in over there. It looks like there's there might be 2 different power supplies here. Check that out. Yeah, kind of divide it there, right? So there's a little 8-pin chip there and there. There's what looks like a little surface mount MOSFET package there, and another one there. Capacitor, inductor, capacitor, Okay, and what is that? That is an input protection diode, probably, by the looks of it.
4 USB port step-down power supply converter board module DC 12 volts, 24 volts, 40 volts to 5 volts, 5 amps. Wow. From Top Electronic 1980, currently selling for, well, they're selling it for $320 American or $423 Canadian. I got it at auction for $2.09, with free shipping, of course. Okay, so it is using TPS 40057 chips. I'll have to take a close look and see if that's what it really is. I assume it is. 5 amps maximum. Actually, I probably want to look at this guy's data sheet just to see what its maximum safe input voltage really is. I know this thing's promising, what, up to 40 volts? Oh, we shall see.
So the first thing I see about this board is that it is not running on a TPS 40057. It is on an A2568.
So this 5268 chip is a 3-amp, 28-volt synchronous rectified step-down converter. 4.75 to 28-volt input. Right, so we're already being lied to but a couple of times by the listing, but that's nothing new. There is the basic circuit, and that's probably pretty close to what we've got, I'm guessing. And here is the pinout that I was looking for. So pin 2 is the input, pin 4 is the ground. Right, that should be fairly easy to trace out.
Since this board didn't bother to label the input connector, have to do a little bit of detective work. I figure out where the V in and ground pins of that chip are. I'm assuming that the V in will be connected in parallel with this capacitor and across through this diode, probably. And actually, yeah, I can double check that, but and the ground is probably connected to ground. All right, so pin 2 is the input. And as expected, it does show up on that protection diode. So the other side of the damn it, I can't get in there. Fine, I'll measure it the hard way. Okay. So that first one is the input connection. Fine, that was easy. And now the ground is on pin 4. And there it is in the middle connection. There was something momentarily on that connection. I don't know what it is. Where does it go? It goes off to a couple of pins on that. Was that a 5-volt output, maybe? We'll check it later. Okay, connected up to one of those barrel jacks. And here is about 19-ish volts, I think, coming from a laptop adapter. Yep. So that should be well within its range. Plug that in, and we have a light. That's a good sign. Let's try my first theory here between ground and there. Yep, that is a 5-volt output. Okay, cool. So I think we'd already figured out that there's two separate halves. So this pair here will be on one power supply and this pair one will be on the other power supply. So we need to load it down. And to do that, we will use our fancy little Arruiding power thing. It plugs in, okay. It's set for 0.9 amps right now. 5 volts is what it's measuring. 1.2 amps, 1.5 amps, 1.8 amps. Still 5 volts, 1.9 amps. Oh yeah, there the fan, so solid on, okay. So there's 2.22 amps. That's topped out 4.9 amps and 4.8 volts. Okay. I thought this thing could go higher. Okay. Now I'm plugged into the one on this side, which is the one that's in parallel with this over here. So I can measure the voltage on that. Okay, so that's at 5 volts. That's at 3 amps. This is at 1 amp, so a total of 4. Kick this up to 2 amps. So now we're drawing a total of 5 amps out of it, and it just shut down. Oh, it's restarted. Okay. And it's just shut down again. Let's drop this guy back down to 1 amp. That's restarted. So it protects itself. That's cool, too. It lied to us a little bit. It said it was 5 amp. And actually, I guess, if you want, it's 5 amps across the whole thing. And from the data sheet of that control chip, it said it was a 3 amp anyway. So right now we're running 3.5 amps. And it seems to be happy at that. So we could probably do the same out of each side. Because remember, that's a dual power supply. Wait, let's see. That inductor's getting a little bit warm. Anything else getting warm over here? Oh yeah, our control chip's getting toasty warm. Okay, That's not a bad beer. It's not nearly as heavy and malty as they suggested it would be, but it's not too bad. Anyway, so here is here's today's Mailbag Monday items in all their glory. These two guys took 6 weeks to get here. This guy took 3 weeks. The base plate thing here took 5 weeks. the breadboard jumpers took 20 days and the tape took 20 days. Oh, right, the tape. So shortly after I opened that, I used a piece of the tape to stick this wooden handled wire brush, I guess, onto my vase here, my weighted base vise. And it's been curing for a while. And that's not going anywhere. That's solid. I can pull it off, but that was fairly solid. That's quite weighty. Okay, yeah, so that's another successful mailbag. I think that's going to be a handy little power supply, actually. I might just put that into a box, package it with a laptop power supply, because I've got a few of them kicking around, and just use that for charging things around here and powering stuff. That could come in really handy. This and this were actually restocking my supply after I built that. I ordered these months and months ago. Breadboard jumpers, they're always handy to have around. And this guy, well, it was an auction. It was cheap. And I mean, it can be used any place you would use a CH340 or any other serial adapter. Yeah, that's is that still here? Yeah, that was a good mailbag. Much more successful than the last one, as a matter of fact. Anyway, thanks for watching. I always appreciate hearing what you guys have to say down in the comments below. And as always, a special thanks to my Patreon supporters, including a couple of new ones this month. Thanks for dropping in. Enjoy the early access to all these videos. And I will talk to you guys later.